Our featured speaker tonight is a member of the Chaska Human Rights Commission, and he comes to this church, and he's part of the Indivisible people who are working to make social progress happen, and he's an inspiration to us, and we're really happy that he decided to accept our invitation to speak tonight. Please welcome Donzel Leggett.
Okay, well, good evening, everyone. The first thing I just want to say is, yes, I am a member of the Human Rights Commission of the City of Chaska and a member of the Indivisible Group, but I'm not speaking on behalf of either group tonight. I'm speaking from my heart. The words that I will provide today are my words, my thoughts, my opinions, so don't hold anyone else accountable for what I have to say. As Dean said, my name is Donzel Leggett, and you know, I am very honored and privileged to be here tonight to celebrate the life and legacy of the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., a man who, to so many, was a true hero, a bright light in a dark time, because he had the character to stand up for what he believed was right and the courage to risk and ultimately lose his life to fight hate on behalf of others with love. Now, it's great to be here at Shepherd of the Hill Presbyterian Church. I'm telling you, this is the most welcoming, friendly, positive congregation you'll ever meet. Pastor Dean Seal, who you'll hear from later tonight, he enriches us every week with detailed scripture study, but he links it to current events and issues that not only educate us, but challenge us as Christians. And I'm very excited to hear his message tonight, because I know he's going to bring it. I'd also like to wish him a happy belated birthday. And also maybe pass along a word of warning, that when he asks you if you could provide just a few words at a program, beware. Because he asked me that. I said, sure, I'll do that. I thought I was going to come up and say, you know, it was a great program. Have a good night. Be safe going home. Something like that. Next thing I know, I'm in the program. My picture's in the paper. And it says, I'm the keynote speaker. So thank you very much. You know, I'm originally from Key West, Florida. Key West is an island in the chain of islands called the Florida Keys. It's the southernmost point in the continental United States. It's actually closer to the island of Cuba than it is to Miami. Now, believe it or not, there's two Key Westers in this room tonight. Myself and our wonderful musical guest, Orion Thurston. Yes. Give him a hand. And I want to tell a story about Orion. He doesn't probably know I was going to tell this story, but I think it's important because it really, really told me the kind of person he was. But I think it also is helps set the stage for what the message is tonight. As I mentioned, he and I grew up together in Key West, and you know, we were on the football team. And our senior year, we were co-captains, and he had earned the starting quarterback position. For those that don't know football, that's kind of a big deal, especially in high school. Now, the third week of the football season, there ended up being a choir concert, which may not be a big deal, except, as you heard earlier, this guy can sing. He was also a member of the choir. So Orion, being proactive, went to the coaches on the football team and told them, hey, I have a choir concert, and I'd like to be able to miss practice to attend the concert. I have a big solo. And they said, as football coaches tend to do, you know, choir is not as important as football. If you miss this practice, we're going to kick you off the team. And Orion said, you know, I will make up whatever has to be made up. I'll do whatever I have to do to make up for the practice. But my commitments to the choir team are just as important as my commitments to the football team. They didn't listen. He went to the concert. They kicked him off the team. Now, I think that as I look back on that, that really earned the respect for me, for Ori, and I've never told him that. Because as an 18-year-old, he had the courage to sacrifice his senior season, never going to happen again, as a starting quarterback to preserve his character. 32 years later, he can still look at himself in the mirror and know that he did the right thing. He stood up for what he believed was right. It would be great if we could say the same thing about most of our leaders in government today, that they had the courage to actually stand up for what's right and not for what's convenient on issues that are much more critical to people than high school football. As I said, I'm from Key West. Key West is a little different than Chaska, especially from the weather standpoint. I checked today, it's about 65 degrees warmer in Key West. I talked to my mother the other day. She knew that me and Orion were on a program together, and she's like, God bless you, make Key West proud, but better you than me, because I don't want to be in that cold. But, you know, here in Chaska, yes, it's cold. But what Chaska lacks in warm temperatures, it makes up for in warmth of people. And that's really especially true for the people here at Shepherd of the Hills. I tell you, if you ever get a chance to come to this church, you really feel something special, something very warm. My wife Tracy and I have been attending services here for the last 6 months, and it's been absolutely phenomenal. I mean, I really wasn't going to church a lot up here. She's Catholic. I didn't really dig that. Came here. I told you, this guy brings it every Sunday, and I've been coming ever since. He's trying to make me join. I keep saying, I'm not sure, but... Speaking of Tracy, my wife sitting over there, greatest thing that ever happened to me. I am so fortunate to have a wonderful, you know, wife. We've been married for 23 years. We've lived in Chaska now for 15 years, the longest we've lived anywhere. We have four kids, and they all attended public schools right here in District 112. Three of them, Chaska High School graduates. We hope we have a fourth in 2019. And believe me, it's a hope. You know, I come from humble background. My grandmother never made it past sixth grade. She was a career maid. I mean, that was her role. And I remember that her elbows and her knees would be, you know, as black as this folder from being on her hands and knees scrubbing other people's floors. But she never let a job determine what her character was. She never let a job take away from her self-esteem. She never allowed her job to dampen her spirit. She believed that through hard work, strong character, and community helping each other, she and others could make a better future for us all. She instilled that same belief in my mother instilled that in me. And I was born August 31st, 1968. For those who don't know, that's just a couple months after Dr. King was assassinated. But my mother and my grandmother never represented him to me in a way of a martyr. It was always as a beacon of hope. They talked about Dr. King as someone who challenged us to be better by striving to be the best that we could be and by serving in our community to make this world better for everyone. They taught me that Dr. King dedicated his life to the legacy of positive change and standing up for those who can't stand up for themselves. He was a light in the darkness. It's really important to remember that when Dr. King, you know, first came to national prominence, he was just a private citizen, just like us. He wasn't in public office or anything like that. In fact, he was just a 26-year-old new pastor or new minister for the Dexter Avenue, Montgomery, Alabama church. When he decided it was time to take a stand, a stand with Rosa Parks and others, and lead the Montgomery bus boycott to protest Jim Crow segregation practices that was forcing blacks to sit in the back of the bus. His house was soon bombed for that decision. He was 26 years old. But even in the face of danger for him and his family, he stepped up. He answered the question, if not me, who? If not now, when? He went on to eventually become the most prominent leader in the civil rights movement. All throughout that time, though, he was still a private citizen. Now, some people only know Dr. King as a civil rights leader who fought for racial equality. If that's your view of Dr. King, it's myopic. Because Dr. King fought for equality for all. He fought for women's rights. He fought for economic equality. He fought for equal access to housing and education. He fought for the rights of organized labor. He fought for all who were marginalized, discriminated against, persecuted, and disadvantaged. He started the Poor People's Campaign almost 50 years ago, I think, this year. He led marches in large northern cities like Chicago, protesting the not having access to affordable housing for all people. And in fact, he was in Memphis, Tennessee, the fateful day of his assassination, to speak at the request of striking sanitation workers' union. Dr. King lived by his values. He wasn't perfect, but no man or woman is. Only one person is perfect. But I say this with strong conviction. He was a great man because he had the character to stand up for what he believed in and the courage to put his life on the line to make the lives of others better. Now, there's certainly a lot of progress that's been made since Dr. King's assassination. But clearly, there are many issues, many problems that we still have to solve and that appear to be getting bigger all the time. Now, we live here in Minnesota. It's a great place to live. It's a great state. We live in Chaska, most of us. Chaska's a pretty good city. But in our state and in our community, there are still many people who are struggling right now. One painful example is homelessness. On any given night in our state, up to 15,000 people experience homelessness. Now, there are many reasons for homelessness. Certainly, lack of employment would be one. Chronic health problems is another. And certainly, there are still discriminatory housing practices in this state, in our county, and in this city. But honestly, the number one reason here why homelessness is so high is the lack of affordable housing. There simply aren't enough affordable apartments, and the ones that are available, people can't get into them. It's the same thing on starter homes. There's very few starter homes available that are an affordable price range for an average family. And that's why in Carver County, home ownership for people who are 30 and under is down 33%. Now, there's some great people and organizations trying to do something to solve this problem. Beacon Interfaith Housing Collaborative of Congregations is committed to ending homelessness through housing. The Families Moving Forward Shelter Program and public advocacy as well. Shepherd of the Hill works directly with Beacon on Families Moving Forward. And in fact, they use their basement here as a homeless shelter at least 4 weeks out of the year. Beacon and Shepherd of the Hill are providing light in the darkness. Now, Dr. King believed that life's most persistent and urgent question is, what are you doing for others? It is up to us as people in our communities to make a difference. The Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. holiday is the only holiday in the United States that has been designated as a day of service. For those of you who have the day off, it should be a day on. A day where you're actually in the community making a difference. Earlier today, several of us from Chaska Indivisible, a group that I'm a part of, volunteered at Launch Ministry. Now, Launch is a faith-based nonprofit which provides support services for struggling young people. Many of these young people have had very serious trauma in their lives. Many of them are or have been homeless. But these young people have more courage and perseverance than any of us can imagine. They just need a little help, a little support to help them successfully transition into adulthood. Corey Magstead and Stephanie Fryant and the rest of the Launch team are doing tremendous work. They are making a difference in this community. They are providing a light in the darkness. Now, I'm sure many of you were very ecstatic yesterday when the Vikings pulled off a miracle.
Yeah!
Several of you probably were sending Stefan Diggs very thank you cards and congratulatory notes and things of that nature. So great job for the Vikings. If you are a Minnesota fan, you've probably noticed the Timberwolves are actually doing good also. Pretty amazing. All right. Why are the Timberwolves doing so good? We know the Vikings, what they're doing, but why are the Timberwolves doing so good? I'll tell you, Jimmy Butler. Anyone know the story of Jimmy Butler? You should Google Jimmy Butler and read about his story because it's absolutely incredible. I'm going to give you the abridged version. Jimmy Butler, when he was 13 years old, he's from Houston, Texas. His mother put him out of the house for no fault of his own. He didn't do anything wrong. She just came up to him one day and said, I don't like the way you look. I don't like your look. I want you out of my house. And she kicked him out. He was 13. He had nowhere to go, so he couch hopped from family to family, friend to friend, for a couple of years, until finally, one of his friend's mothers said, you know what? I'm gonna bring Jimmy into my family. He wasn't a big time athlete at the time. She didn't know he was gonna make it anywhere beyond Houston, Texas. She just wanted to provide him a family life and not feel like he doesn't know he's gonna sleep every night. So she brought him in her family. She already had 7 kids in the house. She didn't care because she wanted to help this young man moved to the next stage. She provided the support, the help, the nurturing in a family environment, a secure environment that helped him focus and move his life forward, to work hard, to push himself, because he had that stable base. And eventually, through many trials, he made it to the NBA. It's an amazing story, and I'm not doing it justice. You need to go take a look at the story. But the question is, how many Jimmy Butlers do we have in our community? And I'm not talking about making it to the NBA. I'm talking about young people who simply need a helping hand to transition to the next step of adulthood, stability, where they could have a career, a mechanic, a teacher, a small business owner, a dental hygienist. Stability as an adult and being able to be a productive person in this community and then pass it on and help someone else. It's up to us. We can provide that light in the darkness for those young people. There's no question these are troubling times. We hear hateful words and see prejudicial policies from the president. And we see the inaction and hear absolute deafening silence from many of our leaders in Washington who should be speaking truth to power, standing up for our values of this country, and speaking on behalf of the people. Just last week, terrible racist comments were made about Haiti and all African countries by the President of the United States in the Oval Office in the presence of several senators. Only one of them did his duty and spoke truth to power. The others conveniently claim they didn't recall, or they're debating whether the word used was hole or house or hole or house. Missing the point that we continue to allow our country to be degraded. As Dr. King said, only darkness cannot drive out darkness. Only light can do that. People are fed up with all this. But we have a duty to speak out against the things that don't align with our values, to stand up on behalf of those who can't speak for themselves, to take action to defend and help those that need it, to hold those in power accountable who are complicit and silent, to provide light in the darkness. So tonight, I'm going to close also with some verses from Matthew. Matthew's a very popular disciple tonight. The Sermon on the Mount is one of the most famous sermons that Jesus ever spoke. Obviously, everything he wrote in that's in the Bible that Jesus talked about, most people who study the Bible know. But the Sermon on the Mount is one that's very, very special. I'm going to talk about verses 3 through 10, you know, which most people call the Beatitudes. Now, some people have their own interpretation of what Jesus is saying. I'm going to tell you my interpretation of what I believe Jesus is requiring of Christians in terms of turning on that light. Blessed are the poor, is what Jesus said. I think he's also saying, blessed are those who work for the poor and reach out a hand to pull them up. Blessed are they that mourn, but blessed are those that comfort the mournful. Blessed are the meek, but blessed are those who protect the meek. Blessed are the hungry, but blessed are those who feed and fulfill the hungry. Blessed are the merciful, but blessed are those who define the merciful not as weak, but as strong and courageous. Blessed are the pure in heart, but blessed are those who speak out on behalf of the pure in heart. Blessed are the peacemakers, but also blessed are those who back up the peacemakers. And blessed are those that are persecuted, but also blessed are those who stand up for and will get locked up with, if need be, the persecuted for righteousness' sake. Darkness cannot drive out darkness. Only light can do that. You are the light. You are the light. You are the light. We are the light. Thank you.